Okay, our topic for this afternoon is saved by his life. Saved by what?
His life.
Saved by his life. On the 24th of February, 1738, about 8 years into his ministry, Charles Wesley fell ill. Has anyone heard of Charles Wesley? He fell ill. And his sickness was to death. He was on his deathbed, you can almost say. He was sick in bed. And one of his students, whom he had just started teaching English a few days earlier, came to visit him in his bed. His name was Peter Boller. And while he's visiting there, Peter asked him a question. He says, "Charles, do you hope to be saved?" And Charles said, "Well, yes, of course, I hope to be saved." And then Peter asked him a penetrating question, a question that went right through to Charles' heart. And he said, "For what reason do you hope it?" Here is a man, he's been Christian all his life. He's been teaching and preaching the gospel for 8 years. He's been teaching and preaching the gospel for 8 years, and he's on his deathbed, he's sick in bed, and a person comes and asks him, "Why do you hope to be saved?" Face to face with a penetrating question. And Charles' answer was, "Because I have used my best endeavors to serve God." After 8 years of teaching the gospel, after 8 years of studying and preaching the gospel, Charles was hoping, was basing, was founding his salvation upon his endeavors to serve God. In other words, he was basing his salvation upon his works. How sad. How sad. So the question that I want to put to you this afternoon is, what are you basing your salvation on? Are you saved? Among Adventists, when you ask the question, "Are you saved?" Yes. Here is another heretic, they say. Are you saved? Are you an heir of God? Are you a possessor of eternal life? Are you co-heir with Christ? And if so, if that is so, what are you basing it on? What are you basing your hope of eternal life, your hope of salvation, what are you basing that on? Charles Wesley based that on his best endeavors to serve God. He based it on his works. What about you? What about me? What are we basing our salvation on? Romans chapter 5 and verse 10. If you can turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 5 and verse 10. The Bible tells us a beautiful promise there. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 10. "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." We are reconciled to God by the death of his son, and much more being reconciled. Now, since we have been reconciled to God by the death of his son, we shall be saved by his life. Wow.
Amen.
What does that mean? It's a promise that most of us skim through, read over, and keep going. But what does that mean? If many times I've done that. If you go and ask somebody, a Christian, "Why are you saved?" He will tell you, "Because Jesus died for me on the cross. Because Jesus took my sins away." Hallelujah. Praise God. That's good news. But that's not why you are saved. That's not why you are saved. You are not saved because Jesus died for you on the cross. It might sound like blasphemy, but hear me out. You're not saved because Jesus died for you on the cross. Think about it. God created Adam. God created Adam innocent, I want to illustrate it first. God created Adam and he deposited in his bank account $1 million. What I mean by that? God created Adam innocent, but not only that. God, when he created Adam, he gave Adam his spirit. He made Adam righteous. He made Adam perfect. And he made him one with himself. Amen?
Amen.
You agree with me?
Yeah.
Adam wasn't normal. Adam was up here. Adam was one with God. Adam was perfect. You follow me? God created Adam and he deposited in his bank account $1 million. Now, we all know that Adam sinned. When Adam sinned, he not only lost his $1 million, he not only lost the Spirit of God, the oneness with God, his perfection, but he became in debt. He became guilty. He owed something. Can you see that? So when Adam's sin, or rather Adam's sin, resulted in two problems. Not just one problem, in two problems. Number one, Adam was condemned by his sin. He's guilty. That's one problem, guilt. Problem number two, Adam had no power. He no longer possessed power to overcome sin. He no longer had a righteous life. He lost the Spirit of God. And he was a possessor now of an evil heart and an evil life. In other words, Adam had a legal problem, guilt, and he had a personal, and he had a personal and a practical problem, that is a bad heart and a bad life. Two problems, a legal problem and a personal and a practical problem. A legal problem that has to do with his record in heaven, and a practical and a personal problem that had to do with his heart. Yes? So when I ask you, why are you saved? And you tell me, because Jesus died for me on the cross and he paid my debt. He took my sin away. You have only dealt with one problem. You have only dealt with your legal issue. But you haven't dealt with your heart yet. You haven't dealt with the personal and the practical problem that you have to deal with today. Yes? Man's greater problem, man's greatest problem is not guilt. Man's greatest problem has never been guilt. Man's greatest problem is what's in his heart. Jesus dealt with man's guilt. On the cross we read that the iniquity of us all were laid upon him. Ellen White tells us that Jesus took the guilt, took all our sins and took the guilt of the human race upon himself on the cross. If man's problem was only guilt, then everybody would have been saved. Everybody will be in heaven. But it's obvious that not everybody will be in heaven. Why? Because what Jesus did on the cross, what Jesus accomplished on the cross, deals with one problem of man, the legal issue. At the cross, the emancipation papers have been signed, and we are all declared free. But is everybody free? Just because you legally have been declared free, doesn't mean you're free. You are still in bondage. You following my train of thought? The new birth experience, man's salvation is not merely a legal transaction. Man's salvation is not merely a change of record in heaven above. It's much more than that. The new birth experience, man's salvation has to do with me here today. With me here. You see, The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21. Turn in your Bibles with me there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. The Bible says, "For he," that is God, "hath made him," that is Jesus, "to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." In the English translation, the true meaning of the text does not come out. But if you look at it in the Greek, the two words translated "made" come from two different words. Look it up for yourself. The first word, "for he," God, "hath made him," made Jesus to be sin for us, means appointed or declare, appoint or declare. God had declared Jesus, legally, he declared him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made. The other word in here that is translated as "made" comes from a different Greek word, which means to come into existence, begin to be, or receive being, receive life, the righteousness of God in him. In other words, that we might be made, or that we might receive life, that we might come into existence as being that meet the righteousness of God. Can you see the difference? Jesus was made sin for us. Jesus was declared sin for us, so we can be made, so we can receive a life that meets the righteousness of God. Our "made so we can be made righteous" is not dealing with a legal issue declared. It's not about declaring you righteous legally. It is more than that. It is you receiving a righteous life. It is you coming into existence as a new being. You made the righteousness of God. Amen?
Amen.
So it is much more than a change of a record in heaven. It is much more than that. Salvation has to do with me here on this earth, on this planet, in this body. Again, the verse we read in Romans chapter 5 verse 10 says, "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." The death of Christ on the cross reconciled us to God. But the other problem that God needs to deal with now is the problem that we have here. The only solution for it is the life of Christ. We'll talk a bit more about that now. But can you see the difference between man's legal problem and man's personal and practical problem?
Amen.
Man's legal problem is his guilt, but man's practical and personal problem is his bad heart and bad life. It's a carnal heart and a carnal life that must be changed. So if you go back to the illustration I shared with you about Adam, God created Adam and gave him $1 million. With Jesus' death on the cross, he dealt with man's guilt. Adam went back to zero. He owns nothing, right? If that's all what Jesus did, if that's all what God did is take man's guilt, then Adam went back to zero now. He owes nothing. He's innocent, right? But don't forget, he owes nothing, but he has nothing either. That's why when I illustrated to you, I said God created Adam and gave him $1 million. That the spirit, the righteousness, the perfection, the oneness with God. Adam lost all these things. And all these things needed to be reinstituted to Adam. Needed to be given again to Adam. But how can that be? Christ not only pays my debt, take my guilt away, but he gives me his own life. That life, there is a perfect life, there is one with God, there is righteous. And that's how God saves me. He reconciled me to Him by the death of His Son on the cross, but He saves me by the life of His Son. Can you see that? That's what the verse said. We are reconciled to God by the death of His Son, and being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. By whose life? By whose life? By the life of Christ. See, the process of saving man, in my opinion, that this is harder for God to do than creation itself. He asked me why. Because when God needed to create, there was nothing. He just spoke and it was. To God, this is easy. But for God to save you, He has to change you from a sinner, from the negative, to a saint, to the positive. It's easy for God to speak something into existence, but it is hard for God to get you to give your heart to Him. You see, our problem is that we are used to what the world teaches us. You come and to speak to people today, Seventh-day Adventists, about righteousness by faith, and they tell you, yes, they believe in righteousness by faith, and they go ahead and explain it, and all what it is righteousness by works, and they add to it the term by faith. And the problem stems from what we are used to in our society, the way we grow up. You see, the way we grow up, we are used to having nothing for free. We use it teaching our children. We tell them, if you want to go to the park, you better help clean up. If you want to have breakfast, you better make your bed. We grow up in this culture, in this society, where there is nothing for free. As a matter of fact, we come to believe that if you don't work, you deserve to suffer. There's nothing for free. And you know what? Don't get me wrong. It is important for us to teach our children that there is nothing for free. It is important for us to teach them to work, to earn things. But the problem lies in that when we come to study the scriptures, when we come to study the gospel, we bring our human understanding, our human setup with us. And we read the gospel with the mind that we have acquired through growing up our society and our culture. And as we come to the gospel to read it, we find it very difficult. And this places people in one of two options. Number one, you reject the gospel because it doesn't make sense. It's a fallacy. What do you mean for free? Just believe. It just doesn't make sense. They don't accept it. Or the others, they accept the gospel, but they accept it according to their own terms, because they are used to the fact that there is nothing for free. So they add their own terms to it and they say, well, yes, the gospel is for free. But just before you go, let me give you this list of things that you must do and believe for it to be free. You see what I'm saying? They give you a list and they tell you, you must do this, you must wear this, you must eat this, and you must conform to these, whatever, 27 or as many as you want, lists of beliefs. And then, brother, rejoice with me, the gospel is for free. Well, guess what? You have made it a burden. It's no longer for free. I believe I asked these questions last time here, but as Paul said to me, it is not a burden to ask it again, but to you it is needful. Is the Ten Commandments the gospel? Is the health reform the gospel? Is the dress reform the gospel? No, it's not the gospel. Is a set of a correct doctrinal understanding, is that the gospel? It's not the gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is, in thee shall all nations be blessed. I believe I said that last time I was here. In Christ, the gospel was before preached unto Abraham, Paul tells us in Galatians, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. And of course, it's talking about the seed of Abraham, and the seed of Abraham is Christ. So in Christ, all nations shall be blessed. All the blessings that God can bestow upon you and me are found in one person. It is in Christ. And as you receive this person, You receive all the blessings that God wants to give you. So the question I want to ask you is, have you received the life of Christ? Have you received the life of His Son? That is why it is extremely important for us to understand who the Holy Spirit is. Because the comfort that you receive is the Holy Spirit. And depends on what you believe. If you believe that the Holy Spirit is another person, is another being, is another entity other than Christ Himself, then guess what? You have not received the life of Christ. But if you believe, the Scripture says that the Lord is that Spirit, that Jesus is that Spirit, that God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son, the life of His Son, into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father, then you have truly received the life of His Son. Don't tell me you understand righteousness by faith if you don't understand this basic truth. You just can't. You can't understand it. The only way you can have righteousness by faith is by receiving the life of Jesus. And the only way you can receive the life of Jesus is by receiving what the Bible says, this comforter. But if your comforter is not Jesus, then guess what? Your foundation of righteousness by faith have been destroyed. You have no such thing. Is it a wonder that Satan have brought about this deception? It destroys the gospel. It destroys the gospel. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 19, yet a little while and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. Because He lives, because we live, we serve a risen Savior, we will live His life in us, in this world, today. You see, God is not interested in patching up your life. God is not interested in modifying your life in here a bit and there a bit. Your life is no good. That's the truth. My life is no good. Your heart, my heart is no good. What God wants to do is He wants to take away this bad heart, which the Scripture calls a stony heart, and He wants to give you a new heart.
Amen.
He wants to take away this bad life and gives you a new life. And this is the life of His Son that you receive for free, as a gift. You receive it as a gift. That is why Jesus had to come and live on earth for 30 years and be tempted and gain a victory and then die. Why did He have to do that? Why did Jesus have to be tempted and gain the victory and be tempted like we are tempted? In all points, the Scripture says, He was tempted like we are tempted. Why? The reason I believe is because the life that He lived and He conquered and He gained the victory, this victorious life, He lays down on the cross. He gives it up on the cross. And then that life that He laid down, that has been tempted, that has been tried and gained the victory, He picks up again. He says, here, a gift for you. That's why in Him you're a conqueror. In Him you're victorious. In Him you're righteous. In Him you're perfect. Because you have received a perfect and a victorious and a conquering life. I won't read all this statement from Desire of Ages, but just to emphasize, or rather confirm what I just said, which we found from the Scriptures anyway, but to confirm it, Sister White in Desire of Ages, page 786, she says, to the believer, Christ is the resurrection and the life. You don't only die with Christ, His death is yours. And you don't only live with Christ, His life is yours. That's why He's our resurrection and life. His death is ours and His life is ours. But anyway, let's go on. To the believer, Christ is the resurrection and the life. In our Savior, the life that was lost through sin is restored, for He has life in Himself to quicken whom He will. The life that Adam lost, that $1 million that he lost, in Christ it is restored. How? He, Christ, is invested with the right to give immortality. The life that He laid down in humanity, He takes up again and He gives to humanity. I am come, He said, that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. That's the only way our life can be restored to be one with God. That's the only way we can receive these privileges or this $1 million back again. We are saved by His life. Ye shall be saved by His life, the Bible says. And it means what it says. Your salvation, my salvation, is based on receiving the saved life of Christ, the righteous life of Christ. That is the gospel, brothers and sisters. And that's again what the Bible confirms, as it says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 6, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son, or the life of His Son, into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So why am I saved? What am I basing my salvation on? I'm basing my salvation on the life of my Savior. That is why I'm saved. That is why I have eternal life. Because I have the life of my Savior. Because you have the life of your Savior. So again, the gospel is not just a change of a record in heaven. It's not just a legal transaction. It has to do with me today, here. It's a change of life. You see, this has been God's plan since the beginning. In the sanctuary of old, the sinner would take an animal and sacrifice it to gain forgiveness for his sin. Now, what does that imply? The gospel is illustrated in the sanctuary, but not perfectly. The sanctuary could not illustrate the gospel perfectly. It just couldn't. Nothing can, except the real thing of Jesus on the cross. The sinner takes the lamb and he slays it. The blood goes into the holy place, and once he eats into the most holy place, the sinner is forgiven. But Paul tells us in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 9, we read this yesterday, I'll read it again. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 9, it says, which was a figure for the time then present, the sanctuary, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make the comer thereunto perfect as pertaining to the conscience. Why? Have you ever asked yourself, why would Paul say such a thing? Well, what is he basing it on? Here is the man and he offered a sacrifice. He's forgiven. Why is Paul saying it could not make him perfect as pertaining to the conscience? Because the sacrifice he offered remained dead. Didn't come back to life. The sacrifice that he offered did not give the sinner anything. It just provided life for life, exchange. The sinner needs to die. Here is the life, pointing by faith to the cross. The life of the Savior, end of story, life for life. But the sacrifice remained dead. While on the other hand, Jesus, we're told in Hebrews chapter 10, has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Already by one offering, He has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Why? Because we serve a risen Savior. Because our Savior did not stay dead. He came back to life. And the life that He laid down in humanity, He picks up again and He gives to you. Amen. The sacrifice of Jesus, you gain something from it. Something comes back from that sacrifice to you. Unlike the sacrifice of the animal, nothing came back from sacrifice to you. Can you see that? That is why Paul tells us, come with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. and verses 10 and 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verses 10 and 11. And the Bible tells us, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the what? Life. That the life also of Jesus might be manifest, might be made manifest in our bodies. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh.
Amen.
The life of Jesus has to be made manifest in your mortal flesh, in here on this planet, in this mortal body. That is the gospel. The gospel is not just something about 2,000 years ago what Jesus did on the cross. Praise God for that. And the gospel is not just about what God did in the sanctuary in heaven in the records. Praise God for that. But it is about today receiving the life, the very life of Jesus Christ Himself into our hearts. That life that Jesus laid down 2,000 years ago on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says, let your light shine. Guess what? You are darkness. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. So when the Bible says, let your light shine, it is saying, let the light of Jesus, let the life of Jesus shine in your mortal body. That's what it's saying. All our righteousness is but a filthy rag. We have no light in us. The only light that we can have in us is the light of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible again tells us in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4.
Amen.
And the Bible says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with Him in glory. When Christ, who is our life, Christ is our life today. Do you know that? That is why John said over and over again that you are already a possessor of eternal life. Do you know that? Your eternal life doesn't begin when Jesus comes back. Your eternal life begins today.
Amen.
That's what John said in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 to 13. He said, and this is the record that God has given to us eternal life. Where is this life? And this life is in His Son. He that hath the Son hath life. What life? Eternal life. You have eternal life now, today. Do you believe that? He goes on to say, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of Jesus, of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. Read the words and believe them. That's why John can tell you, you already have eternal life. Why? Because you have an eternal being living in you. You have the life of the eternal being, the Son of God Himself, living in you. That's why you're already a possessor of eternal life. Do you realize that? In many Christian circles, if you say that I'm saved, that's a, whoo, man, you're a Pentecostal. What are you saying? You're saying, hey, Jesus said, if you believe in me, you have eternal life.
Amen.
Can you have an eternal life and not be saved? Don't be scared to believe what the scripture says. Jesus says, if you believe in me, you have eternal life.
Amen.
Believe it. Camp on it. Camp on it, brothers and sisters. Don't let go of it. These promises, I tell you, these promises, if we only understand them. Only if you understand them. Man, I tell you, as I read these words that John said, John, and as I read these things, that you already have eternal life, you're already a possessor of eternal life, how can you contain yourself? You only have two options. Either not believe it, or jump up and down. Rejoice. And I really wonder if you guys believe it, because you're sitting. You have eternal life, brothers and sisters.
Yes.
You do. You do. In Christ.
Amen.
You do. Amen? He that has the Son has life. Is it a wonder then how John, the Apostle John, identified the Antichrist? Come with me to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. In an earlier chapter of 1 John, he said he is the Antichrist that denies the Father and the Son. This has to deal with the Father and with the Son. You're Antichrist if you deny the Father-Son relationship. But notice how he defines the Antichrist again. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 3. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world. Notice what the Apostle John said. He said, it is the spirit of Antichrist that denies that Jesus what?
Flesh.
Say again?
Flesh.
When?
Like me.
When?
When he lived?
When?
And now.
Now. He doesn't say that Jesus Christ has come. He doesn't say that Jesus Christ did come. He says that Jesus Christ is come today in your mortal flesh, that the life of Christ may be manifest in our mortal flesh. How could the life of Christ be manifest in our mortal flesh if Jesus Christ himself is not living in my flesh today? John identified the Antichrist as the one who denies the Father-Son relationship, and he didn't leave the Holy Spirit out of it. John identified the Antichrist as the one who denies that Jesus is not. Rather, the one who denies that Jesus is the Holy Spirit. Because if you deny that Jesus is the Holy Spirit, you are denying that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh today. Notice what one of the 1888 messengers, A.T. Jones, said, commenting on this verse. He says, what then could show a more universal reign of the form of godliness, not only without the power, but denying the power? For this form of godliness will deny that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh, that spirit is of God. Every spirit that confesses not that Jesus is come, and then he comments on it, not that he did come, but now is come in my flesh, Christ in you, the hope of glory, Christ abiding within, God reigning in the kingdom of God that is within you.
Amen.
That is what this signifies, he says. Amen. He goes on to say, every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist. And ye have overcome them, little children, because greater is he that is in you, than he that is in the world.
Amen.
The man was simply reading the scriptures. But greater is he that is in you, brothers and sisters, than he that is in the world. Who is in you?
Christ.
It is Antichrist that denies that Jesus Christ is come today in my flesh and in your flesh.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
That is the gospel. That is the gospel, brothers and sisters. And Satan wants to hide it from you. He wants to take away your foundation of righteousness by faith, because that is the gospel. He wants to take it away and give you another comforter whom we knew not. And your father served not. And by doing that, he takes away the very life of Christ away from you.
Amen.
That's again what Paul says, that I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, Yet not I, but who? Christ lives in me, in my flesh, today. What is salvation? What is righteousness by faith? What is justification by faith? Testimonies to ministers, Ellen White tells us, what is justification by faith? She asks the question and she says, it is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which is not in his power to do for himself. Tell me you're righteous because you do something. Don't tell me you're saved because you have done something. The whole essence of righteousness by faith, the whole essence of justification by faith is laying your glory in the dust and God doing for you what you cannot, even if you want to, what you cannot do for yourself. That is righteousness by faith. So my question for you again, are you saved? Are you a possessor of eternal life? I don't want you to look for the future. I want you to look now. Are you a possessor of eternal life? Are you a co-heir with God? Are you a co-heir with Christ? Are you joint heir with Christ?
Amen.
Don't be scared, brothers and sisters. If you believe on me, Jesus said, you have eternal life. Let no man take that promise from you.
Amen.
Don't let any man take that promise from you. And if you're still not sure, if you are here today, if you're watching this DVD today, and you are still not sure, then look and live. That's what God said in Isaiah 45, verse 22. Look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth. Just look. Just turn your eyes and look upon him and receive life. That's all what he wants you to do. Just receive it. Just look and live. You're not saved because of what you do. You are saved because of what he has done. You are not righteous because of what you give God. You are righteous because of what he has given you.
Amen.
The life of his son Jesus. We're almost done, but I'd just like to read a statement from Ellen White, which puts all what we have seen from the Bible in one short statement, Christ Object Lesson. And I think it's such a beautiful statement that just brings out something that we saw in scriptures. But I want to read it for you. Christ Object Lessons, page 162, paragraph 4. And she says, as the sinner drawn by the power of Christ approaches the uplifted cross and prostrates himself before it, there is a new creation. A new heart is given him. He becomes a new creature in Christ Jesus. And listen to these words. If you've been sleeping, wake up now. Listen to these words. Holiness finds that it has nothing more to require. What? Holiness finds that it has nothing more to require. You're not jumping. Let me illustrate it so you can understand better. A harlot, a prostitute. The harlot hairstyle, the jewelry, the makeup, the short dress, miniskirt, the lot. She's walking to her work to do her night duty. The gospel dawns on her. She heard it before, whatever. She saw a picture, whatever. The gospel dawns on her then and there. She kneels down in a quiet corner on the street and she pours out her heart to God with tears of repentance. There is a new creature. A new heart is given her.
Amen.
Holiness, God looks from heaven at her in her mini skirt, in her jewelry, in her makeup, and he says, I've nothing more to require.
Amen.
Amen.
Nothing more to require. Hey, what about the dress reform? What about the health reform? What about the jewelry? Nothing more to require. As I read this statement and I got to these words, I said, man, come on. You can't, can say that? Surely she got to do something. And then it's as if the Spirit of God, when inspired this woman to write these words, knew that I will be in 2013 reading this statement and ask this question. And then the very next sentence, she says, God Himself is the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. And whom He justifies, them He also glorified.
Amen.
And I felt the Spirit speaking to me and saying, it's not her works that will justify her. It is God Himself who justified her.
Amen.
And He justified her and He will glorify her. Not because of what she will do. Then and there. Why? How could God say that? How could God look at this prostitute, was prostitute, and say, I've got nothing more to require? How could He say that? Because she has just received a perfect, redeemed, justified, sanctified life.
Amen.
The life of His Son Jesus that was laid 2,000 years ago down on the cross. She receives it in her mortal flesh. And God looks and says, wow, perfect. That's the gospel. Dare to believe that. Dare to believe what the Bible says and dare to believe what the Spirit prophecy says. Dare to believe it. Don't be scared. Believe it. Now, let me qualify what I'm saying. Lest Satan takes my word and says that I'm giving license to sin. That woman, when she gets up, because she has received this life, she will not go on to do her night duties that night. She won't do that. Because she has received a new heart, a new mind, a new life. But do not confuse the order. She becomes a new creature first. She is saved. Mark that word. She is saved first. She receives eternal life first. She receives, because she received Him, she receives power first. She becomes a co-heir with God. She becomes a joint heir with Christ first. And then, the fruit will come.
Amen.
Amen.
Do not confuse the order. Don't put the fruit before the root. It doesn't work. It doesn't work, brothers and sisters. Salvation is a supernatural work. It is a gift from God. It is doing something for you that you cannot do for yourself. You know, I like to give illustrations. I'll just give another illustration. Let's say I have sinned. Forget, let's say that. The whole human race sinned, right? There's none righteous, no, not one, the Bible says. Let us not be ashamed of it. That's what the Bible says. We are in a hole. We're stuck. We're in the well. And God walks up on the street and He says, son, walk with me. The things that I want to do, get out of the hole and walk with you, Lord, I cannot do. And the things that I do not want to do, stay here, I end up doing. Lord, I can't walk with you while I'm stuck in the well here. I can't walk with you while I'm stuck in the hole in here. So here is what God does. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace are ye saved, and hath raised us up together out of this hole, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And then, He bids you follow Him. God comes and lifts you out of this hole. He cleans you up. He washes your clothes. He gives you new clothes, a new robe of righteousness. And He puts you up and He makes you sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. He makes you a prince and a princess. And after He does that, He says, now son, now daughter, walk with me. And even then, He knows I can't walk. So He says, you know what? I will take away your stony heart. I will give you a heart of flesh. I will give you my Spirit, and I will cause you to walk with me. And when you fall, I will carry you and make you walk with me. Even after Christ puts you up there in the heavenly places, God puts you up there with Christ Jesus, He still doesn't leave you alone. Sanctification is not you sanctifying yourself. No. I will cause you to walk in my statutes. I will cause you to walk with me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
The gospel, brothers and sisters, is something out of this world. It is so good that our human nature finds it hard to believe. We want to do something. We want to gain some credit. I want to pay something. I want to do something. I want to gain some credit for it. Not here. Not in the gospel. Not in your salvation. You can't. You can't gain any credit. So going back to our story about Charles Wesley. After Peter asked him the question, why do you hope it? And Charles said, because I have used my best endeavors to serve God. The story tells us that at the answer of Charles Wesley, Peter shook his head and said no more. He just sat there quietly. At a later day, Charles wrote, that's from his diary, I thought him, Peter, very uncharitable, saying in my heart, what? Are not my endeavors a sufficient ground of hope? Would he rob me of my endeavors? I have nothing else to trust to. If you are in that situation, brothers and sisters, give up. You can't do it. Just give up. And just receive what he has given you. And let him do it for you. Thankfully, Charles Wesley, about 3 months later, He saw the gospel and understood it, and he lived and he taught the gospel to people, and he broke loose of this legalism that he was in. But it is not uncommon for Christians to miss the gospel. It is not uncommon for gospel-believing Christians to miss the gospel. So I'll just conclude with a couple of questions. Have you received the life of the Son of God? And is Jesus dwelling in your mortal flesh? If your answer is yes to these questions, then let no man rob you of the truth that you have eternal life, that you are saved in Christ, that you are co-heir with God, that you are a joint heir with Christ today. Don't look for it in the future. You receive this life. And John says, Jesus himself said, if you believe on me, you have eternal life. Amen?